One of the funniest jokes I ever heard was delivered on the set of Saturday Night Live ages ago by deadpan comic Stephen Wright, who let it be known that he had visited a museum that had all the heads and arms from the statues in the other museums. And like most well-turned-out jokes, this one sits astride something profound, that there is actually much to be gained in the survey and admiration of the incomplete or uncompleted, the unfinished painting, the prematurely broken-off art of fugue, an archaic torso of Apollo. In Rilke's words, "Wir konnten nicht sein unerhörtes Haupt darin die Augenäpfel reiften. Aber sein Torso glüht noch wie ein Kandelaber, in dem sein Schauen nur zurückgeschraubt sich hält und glänzt. Sonst könnte nicht der Bug der Brust dich blenden, und im leisen Drehen der Lenden könnte nicht ein Lächeln gehen zu jener Mitte, die die Zeugung trug. Sonst stünde dieser Stein unstellt und kurz unter der Schultern durchsichtigem Sturz und flimmerte nicht so wie Raubtierfelle und breche nicht aus allem steinem Rändern aus wie ein Stern. Denn da ist keine Stelle, die dich nicht sieht. Du musst dein Leben ändern." Today we consider something very much like that. In the case of a disarticulated statue, the eye can take it in and the mind can supply the missing details. In the case of music, it's different because most people cannot look at a mere sketch for a large, complicated, demanding piece of music and have any idea what to make of it. It must somehow be brought to a condition of sound in order to be enjoyed. The story of how that happened in the case of the unfinished Mahler 10th is fraught and fascinating. I will not say much about that owing to time constraints, but I encourage you to look into it. The first of the efforts to bring us something like a complete Mahler 10th is the performing version by English musicologist Derek Cooke, who died not long after completing the score in the mid-70s. The second edition of that score is the one that's in widest circulation with extensive commentary by Berthold Goldsmith and brothers Colin and David Matthews. The story they tell is that of how this work was begun, in what state it was left at the composer's death, and how this performing version was assembled from the materials at hand. Since the publication and recording of the Cooke score, other composers have contributed their own efforts, aiming at putting a little more flesh on those bones. Those by Remo Mazzetti and Rudolf Barschai are certainly worth listening to, quite colorful, quite different from each other, each holding out real possibilities for understanding Mahler's intentions. Not all efforts have gone so well. I advise you to steer clear of Clifton Carpenter's attempt to complete the work. It's over the top, grotesque, irreverent, practically an insult to the composer's memory. I doubt Mahler would have recognized himself in it. Mahler began this symphony shortly after completing his 9th. His greatest public triumph had been the premiere of his 8th symphony on September 12, 1910, only 7 months before his death in May the following year. By the time he delivered that celebrated performance, he had already completed 2 more symphonies that he would never hear, the Song Symphony Das Lied von der Erde and the purely orchestral 9th, and was hard at work on the 10th. During his few remaining months of life, and it is by no means sure that he had any inkling how little time he had left, he plunged headlong into what was sure to turn out to be his greatest masterpiece ever. A farewell, to be sure, but quite unlike those of Das Lied and the 9th. Here, the state of mind is much less troubled, although there are, of course, troubles aplenty, for this is music by one of the most troubled geniuses who ever lived. And the final page declines at last into a settled silence that seems fulfilled and entirely at peace. The key is, after all, one of the brightest imaginable, F sharp major. For this symphony, Mahler adopted a formal plan that had served him well in the 5th and 7th symphonies, that of a large arch form or formal palindrome. In the case of the 5th, movements 1 and 2 on the one hand and 4 and 5 on the other frame a large central scherzo that is thus understood as the capstone of a 3-part symphony. Something like that is also true of Symphony No. 7, in which single large movements, the first and fifth, surround a central section that is itself a palindrome, two Nachtmusiken flanking a central scherzo. Not so much the capstone of the piece as in Symphony 5, but rather its nadir. The 10th symphony is more like the 7th than the 5th, even in its proportions. And in place of that central scherzo, there is a curious little movement that Mahler titled Purgatorio, music whose most distinctive feature is a mill of life undercurrent, very much like that of Mahler's Das irdische Leben, one of his Wunderhorn songs written over a dozen years earlier. Flanking that central movement are two scherzo movements of vastly different character. In fact, those two scherzi are so different that I've always suspected that another organizational scheme is actually afoot, and it's one that Derek Cooke also intuited, that the first two movements belong together as an F-sharp major, F-sharp minor pair, standing in sharp contrast to each other, but also serving as complements. There is some manuscript evidence for this view, and it is the formal scheme I've adopted for this analysis. I will thus treat the first two movements of the 10th in this video with the remaining three in a follow-up. I believe a few words about the state of the symphony's completion at the time of the composer's death are in order. Cooke and others have worked mostly from two sources, a four-line sketch that runs throughout the entire symphony, sometimes expanded to five staves, at other times reduced to three, and Mahler's nearly complete orchestration of movement 1 and partially complete orchestration of movements 2 and 3. There is thus a draft orchestral score for movement 1 in Mahler's hand to which relatively little needed to be done. A partly orchestrated scherzo in the format of a full orchestral score, but with quite a bit of material missing, and then the first 38 measures of Purgatorio, likewise orchestrated. After that, there is no complete score at all, and the remaining two movements are constructed entirely from the sketch I described earlier. The Cooke edition is a scholarly one and makes all this clear, furnishing Mahler's sketch beneath Cooke's orchestration. It's impossible to describe this symphony adequately in introductory remarks like this, but of course the music's the thing, and it will speak quite clearly for itself. It's my job, however, to prepare you as best I can for the experience you're about to have, especially if you have not had it before. The opening movement is an adagio, although that tempo is not indicated until measure 16, when an eerie, unaccompanied section solo for the violas playing at a noncommittal andante pace, tonally unsettled despite the F-sharp major signature, finally gives way to full-throated orchestral song. The thematic substance of this movement is largely drawn from that introductory paragraph and the orchestral song that follows it. The lines are unbelievably rangy, with the first violin's melody spanning a full melodic 20th, something like what one hears in Schoenberg's third quartet, but harmonically constrained, if just barely. Regular alternation between those two ideas results in a movement organized in cyclic form, by which I mean recurring patterns of paired themes. You may recall that the finale of the 9th symphony was organized that way, and a case could even be made for the first of its movements as well. There is, of course, another kind of cyclicity that is vital to this symphony, the symphonic cyclicity, in which themes heard in earlier movements return, usually in a transformed state, in later ones. During the second half of this ample, broad-paced movement, a crisis of almost unbelievable ferocity erupts, rising to a horrible peak on a dissonant chord that contains 9 pitch classes, an ugly, lethal projectile of astonishing sonic fury hurled again and again at a screaming high A in the trumpet, spending itself in an explosion of purest musical expressionism. Thereafter, the music gathers itself, licks its wounds, and proceeds to a largely reconciled sounding ending, but with much work still lying ahead. That is the project that the second movement takes up. This F-sharp minor scherzo is surely the most undanceable such movement ever written, and I'm in awe of any conductor who can manage all those meter changes while retaining at least a modicum of podium dignity. This restless, implacable music is placed again and again in counterpoise to a danceable waltz whose main thematic idea is clearly based on the first movement's great adagio theme. These two ideas succeed each other with calculated regularity such that this movement can also best be understood in cyclic form terms. There's a lot of conflict in this movement, but the ending is an unalloyed F-sharp major triumph, and Mahler might well have ended his 10th symphony there, much as he might have ended Das Lied von der Erde with the 5th movement, with perfectly satisfactory results. But in both cases he went on, and that is what I will do with the second video in this two-part series. The recording is by the BBC Symphony under the direction of Gianandrea Noseda. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.